It's John Cleese.
Thank you. Thank you, Pam. Thank you.
An evening with the late John Cleese. Tell us, how live is this live show? It sounds insane.
Well, it's it is now. I've been dead about 7 weeks now, as you know. You probably saw it in the papers, and I've got quite a lot to report, which I think people will be interested to hear.
John, on the theme of this, do you actually think about death much?
Oh yes, I've always been interested in it. I think it's part of life. I mean, I think it's very important to look at it. In fact, I have a whole section on it in the show. And when I start on it, the audience goes, whoops. And by the end, they're laughing their heads off. And people say to me afterwards, you know, I feel much better about it now.
You are someone that looks like you enjoy living. Are you scared of death?
No, but I hope I can postpone it as long as possible. But what I do, you see, I'm a little eccentric. I have all sorts of odd interests that people don't expect, and I actually think that there's some form of afterlife, that something happens to most people after they die. And the evidence for this is quite extraordinary, and I'm attached to various groups, mostly academic people, who believe this to be the case. And although I don't think we know, have any idea what goes on, I have evidence that something must go on because the evidence is overwhelming. And of course, the scientists will say it's rubbish, but that's because they can't explain anything. Well, can't explain it.
I read that you said that the coronation of King Charles reminded you of a Monty Python sketch. Did you watch the coronation? Did you stand up and take the oath of allegiance or anything?
Well, I wasn't going to, because I find solemnity has always, even since I was a 15-year-old, very solemn occasions. I find them, I don't know what it is. I find as I can't breathe properly because all spontaneity is carefully put aside so that there aren't any mistakes. And solemnity is a marvelous thing for hierarchy. If you have a lovely, humorous, good-natured atmosphere, it's very hard for people to pretend they're more important than each other. Do you see what I mean?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The moment you allow any humour in, that kind of hierarchy disappears, dissolves. So they have to make these occasions very solemn. So my wife, who was watching television in bed with the cats around us, she said, come and watch a bit of it. And I came as Charles was coming in, and I leaned down on the bed and looked fixed at the screen, and I just started to laugh uncontrollably because it was people in silly costumes pretending it was all very serious.
I'm intrigued to know, if you were there, if you'd gotten an invite, what would you have been tempted to do? Like, what does the sort of inner John Cleese, yeah, how do you react?
Yeah. I would have bought a big supply of whoopee cushions.
That would have spiced it up a bit. I'm with you. I'm with you, John. Hey, they say that you shouldn't mix business and family. What are your thoughts on that? Because you perform with your daughter, Camilla. Is she funnier than you?
Yes, on some things, she's a very, very funny young woman. But what we do best together, I mean, she's very good when she kind of acts as interlocutor because she knows all my jokes and still pretends that they're funny. And what she does is she has the most wonderful off-the-wall ideas. I'm very good at the carpentry and she's good at the wild ideas. It's a little bit like I used to be when I worked with Graham Chapman.
It's very big news about Fawlty Towers coming back. What made you want to reboot such an iconic series?
Well, I had resisted it for 40 years, and then I suddenly saw how you could do it, which is to get away completely from the old series. I was setting it perhaps in the Caribbean, in a sort of holiday hotel, rather exclusive one. I mean, it won't be as funny as the original because that's the best I can do. But it, you know, it could still be funnier than a lot of stuff out there.
Hey, John, the world has been remembering Barry Humphries recently. We've lost this iconic icon, and I know you've had a lot of lovely things to say about Barry Humphries. I wonder whether one of the things you like about Barry is that he didn't seem to particularly care too much what people thought of what he said.
Yeah, I think that's right. You see, the creative process is really spoiled the moment that you start thinking, oh, am I allowed to say that? Am I allowed? Can I get away with saying that? It completely interrupts the creative process. And I have a very good friend of mine who's producing the TV series I'm doing at the moment, and he's a stand-up comedian. He was in America recently, and he said, I was struck that the American comedians in comedy clubs seem to be much more relaxed than the English comedians, and therefore much funnier. He first said, I feel that the English comedians now are sort of holding back all the time because I was thinking, oh, is this going to offend someone? And the answer is, it probably will offend someone. So what?
What do you think when you do? When that happens, it inevitably happens, and you have. What do you think when that, you know, when the uproar happens? Does it bother you?
But you see, if I was on television a lot of the time, then I would have to take that into account. But in the audiences that come to see me, they're not offendable. You don't find Monty Python fans saying, I'm not going to go to that show, it might be offensive.
John, you've been doing comedy for such a long time now, and for so much of that time you've been one of the most famous comedians, you know, in the British world, in the
what
world.
Do you mean one of the most famous comedians?
Well, I guess with that...
You're being undermined by yeah. Michael Hing. He's doing it very subtly, John Cleese.
I guess what happens, though, is that you would have, I imagine, random people coming up to you on the street all the time, quoting back iconic sketches, lines, you know, serious comedy jokes from your past. Can I ask you, genuinely, has that ever been enjoyable for you, ever?
Oh, yes. I mean, the only thing is, when people come up to you and start gushing, you know, and saying how wonderful you are, the question is, what are you supposed to say? I mean, I usually say, yes, I know. The funny thing is also that they want to do the talking. They don't, and so you just sit there and all you have to do is smile and nod and be friendly, and eventually they go away.
You have the best laugh ever, John Cleese. I haven't heard it enough. You're always making everyone else laugh, but your laugh is exceptional.
You should have heard me rolling around on the bed at the coronation.
Tickets to an evening with the late John Cleese are available now. Get it before it's too late. Anyway, head to our website for all the details. Would you please thank the one and only John Cleese?